context, and I don't see it. Yeah. So if the context here is I, it would mean I didn't say it, someone else said it. Right? If the context is never, it means I didn't say it. If the context is said, it means I didn't actually say it, I really liked it. If the context is he, I said someone did, not necessarily that particular person envisioned here. So the point here is that depending on how you're looking at the sentence, how you're looking at the word, you can have so many different meanings. Right? Alright, so the first way of trying to decipher what it means is something we call propositional semantics. And what that means basically is we're trying to convert the flow of text into logical language units, something like mathematics. Right? Imagine someone says this. So let's look at this. Alright. So this is a very interesting question. What is the largest prime less than 10? Right, that's mathematics, obviously. And we know the answer is 7. Right. But if you try to fit this into any system, the system will know what to do. Because these are just x units. So it means that for this system to understand what you want it to do, it needs knowledge of mathematics. So what propositional semantics says you should do for a situation like this is that you convert the block of text into a logical language unit. Meaning you want to link each input in your input and the existing knowledge. So if you come at this point, now for a typical NLP system, it's very difficult for you to link raw text to the knowledge of mathematical facts. So if you if you have any system and you just type what's the largest prime less than 10, it's not really going to understand what you're saying because it doesn't have any knowledge of mathematics. So propositional semantics say, okay, do you want, right? The universe, if you're familiar with set theory, the universe theory of mathematics, right? Just give it the universe with all the mathematical knowledge that you need for that particular instance. So when you get there, then you can now use that system to answer this question using an NLP system. So propositional semantics is combine pieces of knowledge together to infer an answer. What that means is that you want to convert this particular question, what is the largest prime less than 10, to its logical form, and this is the logical form. Right, this is what the question is saying you should do. Right, the largest prime less than 10. This is what it's saying. So what you want to try and do is, or what logical, what propositional semantics say you should do is, convert that particular sentence into the logical form. Now this is the logical form of that sentence. There are more examples of propositional semantics. Another example is don't bite man. Right? There's an action and there are arguments, and you see that bite is a binary relation. Both man and dog are objects. So propositional semantics is give the universe with this guy that combines the two of this guy. So if you want to build a system that does this, all you have to do is take individual units in your sentence. Dog, bite, man. Right? The action here is bite, and the two subjects are the dog and the man. So that's what we're trying to derive meaning from text in natural language. There's there's also the logical derivation here. Socrates is a man, all men are mortal, and so therefore Socrates is a mortal. That's another example of logical semantics. This is a very good example of one of the popular uses of propositional semantics, right? Gene regulation. So you have the repository of articles. Right? From these articles, you can get the text. Now from the text, you try to reach shallow and infer the subject and the object from them. As long as the subject, the object, and the verb from your text. Now from there, you have the model suggests revisions to you. From the different, you have an assembly of revisions here. Right, you revise again, you have the model manager, and you come to the reasoning part here. You don't need to worry too much about this. Propositional semantics is just, I don't want to call it old, but it's leading us to where we are going, so you don't really have to focus too much on this. You just need to understand that there is something that exists that's called propositional semantics. And what it says is, if you want to if you want to derive meaning from words, from sentences, try to build logical units, logical forms of these sentences. That's basically what propositional semantics says. The next method of trying to derive meaning is deep dictionary lookup. Everyone here knows what a dictionary is. Not the dictionary Python. You know what a dictionary is. Even if you think of it as a normal dictionary, it's two words either way. So what this method says is build an associative mapping. You know, give a dictionary. There's an example like that here. Let me just say, there's a line of code here. Let's use this sentence as an example. Associative mapping between words and ideas. So what dictionary lookup says you should do is this. If you want to try and derive meanings of this, do the dictionary where each one of this is a key in your dictionary and the value is a unique ID. Right, the unique ID can be whatever it is you want to be. It can be a hash, it can be a number, if you want to be a number. So just give an associative mapping between the words in your text and unique IDs. The only thing you need to do here is thematization. I imagine everyone knows what that is. So the mapping allows you to carry out different operations by using integer representations. For example, you can say, if you say this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, you can use the integer representation of each one of these words to do this, whatever arithmetic operation you want to do to get something like that. A typical example would be here's an example. If you look at it, it says something that's there. This is a typical example of a dictionary book, right? The words in the sentence are Danish, French, human, mandate, OBC. Now, what this represents is that each one of the words in this sentence has been represented with the unique ID. The ID here, you can decide to go with a number. You can decide to use whatever it is, maybe unique hash or choices here. I use an ID here. And this OVC here means an out of vocabulary text. Right? It means a particular text that is in your initial sentence that when you need it somewhere else, it's not really there. So you just represent it with a unique key. If you check all of the OVCs, they are all 18. So it's unique, meaning that whatever word is here doesn't exist in your initial vocabulary. So that's basically what dictionary for. The major disadvantage of this is the assumption of the natural order. And it's so obvious if you look at the example here. In this example, you can see an ideal system would think that there's some order here, meaning that something like OV is more important than all the other words, mind is more important than all of them, which is not true. So that's the disadvantage of dictionary lookup. There's a solution to it, which is to create unique entries. You know, you have let's look at it from this. Let me see this example. We can create unique entries instead. Look for similar items. We can say woman, mandate, man. Have similar words, man. Right, and you batch them together as one unique representation in your dictionary report. Then you look for other similar items, and then you batch them together. Now, if you look at it in product, that's basically what label encoding is. Yeah. That's what you need label encoding. So try to batch it. It's exactly the same thing. So what solution to dictionary report is label encoding? Right. So I'll start to shine. Oh, this one is very popular. Everyone knows this one, nothing for you. So you use the set of all these things what's in your text. Right. In most cases you don't need the processing for one of the encoding. Because all you're looking at is as much. Some people decide to lemmatize and stem, but in most cases you won't need any preprocessing technique for this. It's always better than dictionary lookup because it holds more words. Right? Because what you have is a metric representation of your sentence. This is a typical example of the one that's included matrix. Now, what it does, what this type does is this. If you check each of the rows here, right, there is an item, there's a column there that has one, and every other column has zero. So it means that at this point, whatever word it is you represent exists here, but it does not exist here. So what it basically does is represent every other thing with zero, except the current item. That's one of the criteria. It does not include similarities, which is a very big disadvantage of this. And the entries are statistically orthogonal. What that means is this. Here's a very good example. You have the, let's say you use a search engine, right? And you want to go on the authorization to, search, right? And somebody comes and does hotels in Lagos, and hotels in Lagos, who wants to return the same response. But one of them is going to return the same response, because if you look at this, this is where this guy is present. But this other guy is present at this point. So they are completely different items. So that's the big disadvantage of one of the process. Right? There's a solution to one of the query, which is OneNet. Right? OneNet, everybody. You're familiar with it, right? Do I need to say what OneNet is? Or is everyone familiar with OneNet? Everybody here has just ended up in game. Okay. So OneNet is like this big repository of synonyms and words and their synonyms. I think they call them cisnets, right? Words, their synonyms, hyphenates, So it's this very big repository. So what it means, if I'm given a large matrix where every synonym of a particular entry is matched to it. A typical example is this. We start with hotels in Lagos. Right? You know that hotels are synonyms, right? So you can say for every synonym of hotel, you match them to this initial guy. So if anybody comes and searches for anywhere that has hotels, it matches everything in that particular line. But there are a lot of problems with OneNet too, because it's not updated regularly. I think the last update I'm aware of was in 2012. It requires a lot of human labor to maintain, because people have to be manually, having to create a list of words and their synonyms. It's always very, very difficult to maintain. And it does not represent the nuance of it. So that's that about OneNet. So this is supposed to be the main topic for today, right? Distribution of vector space models. So what these do is now they represent words as a point in the vector space, right? And they work with the general assumption that words that have similar meanings will go together in most cases. And there's this popular saying that everyone uses in the NLP, you shall know your word by the company it gives. So a typical example is this chart here. If you look at this, the words here have very similar meanings. Pelican, raptor, seabird, bird, and finch. They're all birds. Right, so what distributional vector space models try to do is let's take words and represent them in a particular vector space, such that every word that focus around that word must have or should have a similar meaning to it. So that's basically the assumption this works with. So it makes the assumption that for each word W in the text T, except for all the occurrence of W and the words close to it. Right? The typical example is this. This is the word secret. Right? You look at all the words close to this, and this would be the vector space representation of this. Meaning each one of these words have similar meaning to this particular word. So if you pick any word here, it's the same thing. If you pick any word out of any pair of words, you know, that will go together, they should have almost the same meaning. That's what this guy wants to do. So the closest is represented by a predefined constant k. And you represent the number of words to the right or left, or sometimes both of the word that should be considered. This is a very good example here. I think it's all the little tricks and enhancement that starts to cut that explanation. So if you take a k, remember k is the predefined constant, right? The number of words you want to consider. Right? So if your context for here is enhancement and k is 2, you are considering tricks and that and start. So depending on what the value of your constant is, that will determine what the neighbors of this point that you consider are. So the occurrence is then stored in a matrix, right? And the matrix, the rows in the matrix represent the points and the columns represent the context. So look at this guy. This is another very good example. I like to play the end, I like to be angry flying. Right. I like enjoy people at the channel. I like this. Right. So what this does is remember what we are doing here is representing the rules represent the words and the colors represent the context. Mm-hmm. So what's happening here is that for every word you're marking the occurrence, right? I like. Right. I like that first guy again. So this goes twice. Right? So you check I and line. Right? Line in the sentence I. So this matrix is going to go for us. I just remember the difference is it's taking. So the entries in this case are either the counts, you know, the frequency counts, which is what I use here, or it can be the TFI representation of the. Words themselves. You can normalize that to get the probability distribution of how likely each word is likely to appear as a neighbor to another word. So let me explain this again. I like deep learning, I like NLP, and I enjoy flying. If you look at the coherence matrix, flying appears only once. Right? And in fact, it's for all the word for it, enjoy. So enjoy is here. Where's the same thing here? Right? So you can do the same thing for all the words there. So if you now want to check how likely the word is is to appear to another word, what you want to do is to calculate the probability. Okay, so you normalize this to get the probability distribution of how likely this is to appear. So I'll move on to that. This particular distributional vector space model uses a lot in word similarity, total complete suggestions, and other things like that. So there's one obvious problem with this. I don't know, can anyone figure it out? There's a problem with this particular representation. And then we'll figure it out. Anybody? Should I explain it again so you can talk about it again? Let me explain it again. Alright, so you have these are three sentences. Right? Each one of them, this one has a numerics 4, 3, 3. Right? So what you do is in your coherence matrix, you have all the words here. The same thing here. So then you have a coherence here. Now, there's a problem here. That, and I forgot the full subject with that, because it's also important to think about that. The problem here is that this matrix grows as number of when you have increases. So let's say you're dealing for a book that has 1,000 words, or you're comparing very, very large documents. Right? It means that this matrix will grow like as large as the number of words you have. Right? That's a clear problem with this. So one solution to fixing this problem is in the SVT. Right? A singular value decomposition. How about the thing from the past here? I think in the meantime, let's move on. So there's a concept here I want to try and explain. It's a matrix concept. It's not very hard to understand. So I'll prepare to explain it using the format on the computer. But what this basically does is try to reduce the size of the matrix to something you can work with. That's, you know, the summary. This is where we are going to. Am I going too fast?
Yes.
Yes? Am I going too fast? Have I said anything wrong? Let's take a break. Yeah, 5 minutes. Anybody? Just say something. So everyone understands everything I say so far. That's interesting. Even I don't understand comments in that sense.
Can you say
before that I start? So let's just start with picking and answering that. We are looking at ways of representing Benin. Explain propositional semantics, dictionary recall, form of characterization, DBSM, and maybe I'm moving on to one. Propositional semantics. Okay. What propositional semantics says typically is that if you want to derive the meaning of the text or words in the text, you get logical form for it. And in most cases, you use propositional text for sentences that contain logic.
That's right? What you're talking
about with
hash function.
The word? Right. Yes. A is my father. B is my mother. I try to make sense of it. Is A with B. No, you can come up with a logical representation of who A is in relation to B. So that's basically what propositional semantics says. It says just try to represent the words itself, the text, in a logical form. And when you have the logical form of that particular text, and then try to convert it to code or hypertext you want to implement it, which is this same example I give here. What is the largest prime less than 10? I know the answer, or I should know the answer, but the answer is there. You can calculate the answer, but ideally, if you type this text into any sort of system, the system won't know what you're trying to do. So, what logical semantics says you should do is represent this, your trans, right, into its logical form. And for it to get its logical form, you need a context. The context here was the knowledge of mathematics. So this knowledge of mathematics is a word knowledge in relation to this particular quadrant. That's the word of conventional semantics. So any other person?
How do you represent the knowledge of
how do you represent
it?
So I have another example.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, can you take any other example from what?
From the quadrant. From
the
so what's the maximum prime content?
So,
much. How do you like
okay, so let me explain the idea. Right. So when I say logical form, I mean simple form. Right. Consider this a very good example. Don't fight smart. Right? In this case, you don't need any more knowledge. All you need is the logic. There's an action and there are two subjects here. Right? The dog and the man. So in this case, if you want to represent this in logical form, the bites, which is the action, the dog, and then the man. I don't know if you understand that means. Now, if you go back to the previous example, in this example, there's a need for context. Because it's not just a normal question. It's a mathematical question in this particular scenario. And the context we need here for knowledge of mathematics. I don't know if you get one thing. So if you go up again, I think I mentioned this here, is what prepositional semantics does is that converts a block of text into a logical language unit. Right? And then from there you link the word meaning to existing knowledge. So you try to take each word in the sentence and you link it to existing word knowledge. In this case, mathematics, which was the example we used before. Most times it's true, sometimes it's not true. And as such, they should have a similar vector representation. So, but as opposed to distributional vector space models, what embeddings do you speak for about default neural networks to do their own representation? And take words from a vocabulary and embed them as vectors, right, into the lower dimensional space. Then you fine-tune the vector to output, you fine-tune the representation to output vectors. Vector in low dimensional matrix is called embeddings. All of this is saying is this. You take each word in your particular in your sentence. Let's go back to this example we used before. What else? So what this is saying is this. Let's use this as an example. You have to have jaguar, cheetah, tiger, leopard, and panda. So if you start with a tiger, what embedding is saying is take this guy, represent it as vectors in the low dimensional space. Right? If you do it for every other thing here, and you run some biographic operations on this, you notice that you can get some results. So that you can do a popular example. King minus. I can't remember, right? Something minus something will give you a point. Right? The idea is this is sort of everything in what I mentioned. Like all the architectures and everything. You have three main methods. Right, three main architectures rather. Benjamin has its own, Coriolis has its own, and then there is Niccolo, which is the more modern one that we use. So, So let's imagine this is your input. This is your input, right? Benjamin decides to use the pancake activation, right? And then you use a soft max layer here. Remember what we are trying to do is this. We have a sentence, I on the ring. Right. What's all the embedded says you can do is take each one of these words and represent them as vectors in low space, right? Low dimensional space. So just assume you have a vector representation of this. Right. So in this case, you have three integers. Sequences. So what Benji is saying is this, using an H activation, they use a softmax layer. Everyone knows what softmax layer is. I think today's the case where you think that. So you have the EQs here, I am hungry. But there's a very important thing you need to consider, which is the context. Right, if this is the vector you are getting, and the neighbors would be, let's just two words. Let's look for something. Liverpool, United, right? This is a very good example. If this is our context, and we are looking at a neighbor of two, right? We consider both of these and just one of these, because there's just one word after our context, right? So in this case, you can represent this as if this is your context word. If this is your context, you can say the word before it is C, W of C minus 1, and W of C plus 1. So you can go as far as you need it to be, as far as you need it to be, depending on what it is you're doing. So that's that's Benji's architecture of what embedded is. And he was really the first, Benji was really the first guy that came up with this concept. Or no, Benji wasn't, I think the DBSM concept came out in around 1960, correct. Benji's own was like the first modern one in the, if I'm looking at this from the early 2000s. I think this guy was the first one. So Nikolov is the one that everyone uses today, or was the inspiration for what everybody uses today, and it was what led to the concept of what's a vector, you know, which is everyone here has heard of what's a vector. So what Nikolov tries to do is do not use a hidden layer. Don't use any hidden layer, just use everything the way you read this is. Benjo says if this is our input, right? You get these guys here and you sum them, right? And then you land with the options layer, which is also a softmax in this case. So at this point there's a hidden layer here. Right. For Benjamin for Nikolov, rather, Nikolov says okay, get rid of this guy here. So that way you have get just the summation of all your inputs from wherever they're coming from. And then you pass it to the output layer. So this particular architecture is pushing it so far, so we should just start. So Nikolov says given the vectors of your word in a large vocabulary C, right? Go through every position to see and calculate the similarity between the neighbors. That's basically what he says. We have this word keep as our context, right? Represent each one of these as vectors. Let's call this V1, let's call this V2, and let's call this V3. Now go through each one of these guys, keep it a constant. If the constant is one, you're only considering this and this. If it's two, you're considering two. And then calculate the similarity between the constants, the cosine similarity. The modern method that decides to use any of that, or you can decide to use any of that similarity function if you want. So when you go through the process of the plan, he uses the cosine similarity. I think it's there. Please do. I think I'm too fast. I don't know. Or what part? Everything. There are a lot of things there. In that particular thing, we know that's not the issue. Until a number of people were not satisfied, said, do I can make this thing better? So Mikhailov came and said, okay, instead of having this layer here, why not just remove it? Right? At this point, I just have the sum of this guy here. Right? So here we have the sum. But we could have introduced two new ways of doing of representing what vectors, two new architectures, the CBAL and the skew graph. Right? So everything I explained now is what we said before. So CBAL and skew graph are the concept of going to now. So do you understand the time I move on? So any other question?
This is Yeah.
I think build is very important because because a lot of modern cases, there's still more people using neurons than actual words and text. So I think it's very important that you understand it. It's really interesting to get it. The initial sentence we use was today. It starts today. What was the best decision to use? Just consider the neighbors of this guy. And Bloom says, okay, instead of considering the neighbors, just this neighbors, why not just consider the global neighbors of this particular word? Meaning that just instead of considering just the K equals to the K, why not select global, meaning look at the words that come way, way before it, even outside its neighbor constants. So what the guy is saying is that what the vector does not look beyond the words outside the single constants. That's one challenge for the vector. Meaning, if there's two words come together. This king is the king is a man, right? The king is a man. If you view the world with Becky, you know that there's obviously a relationship between king and man. Right. Now, what is also a relationship between. Can you say no? No? Alright, so I'm explaining to you. Right. We have the sentence. Let's call it W. The king is a man. Right. What's the vex is just compare the neighbors of this guy. So we know that king, man are quite similar. But if you have a sentence where the queen is a woman. Right? You obviously know that there's a relationship between king and queen, and man and woman. Right? But in most cases, this guy here, what's the thing is not going to consider this as being related, so he's not going to consider this as being related to this. Because if you take this as a context word, right, it's only for, and let's say your case to the or three. To consider this three, nothing more, nothing less, just a three, right? But Bloom tries to say, okay, just get the global average. Instead of considering this on the neighbors itself, just check everywhere and see what relationship comes out there. So, Bloom uses the global world occurrence and the local context, meaning it uses this and also check the similarity between the words in text and other words in the text. The glove paper, I think, was written by Sam, but they actually proved that the occurrence of two words as opposed to their the global occurrence, rather, the ratio of the global occurrence as opposed to just the occurrence is what is important. To explain this, there's a very good example that is very popular when you're reading about Blue. Let's assume that W is a word that is closely related to ice, or not steam. Ice, steam, right? Since solid is related to ice, but not to steam, you know, we have the. Let me try to go So we have W is a word that is related to ice, but it's not related to steam, right? But it goes on to say that solid is related to ice. So we know that solid is related related to this guy. So solid is not related to steam, right? So what Bloom is trying to say is that the probability of ice and solid would be high. Or let's say to be high, because there's a relationship between them. And the probability between ice and steam would obviously be lower. So what we're just trying to see here is also the private person solution seems to be a bit low. So if you're not trying to combine the probability, you notice that the probability of solid applies, right? The probability of these two and the probability of these two. Right, if you consider the probability of these two and these two, it will be very high. Okay. I don't know if you get that. There's also an illustration of this part that I think. Okay. So this is a more empirical view into what I'm explaining. If you have a word, let's say the word we are assuming here is something like this, key, right? The probability of key and size is let me explain in this way. Let's assume you have a graph. You have ice here, you have solid here, you have water here, and you have steam here. This soon high, you have high probability. Because you can easily move from the bed to the bed. Right. This guy also has a very good relationship with this. Right. Now, this guy too is this guy is related to this. Alright, this guy is related to this. But there's no direct relationship between ice positive. So what Brooke is trying to say is that the probability of words, if this is similar to this, and this is similar to this, it means that if you find a word that is similar to ice, right, and is also similar to water, there's a very high probability that the word will have the same meaning as this guy. So instead of just using the occurrence, just use the probability of the occurrence between them. So in that case, you notice that these words may not even be together in the sentence. But they have technically the same meaning. So Bloom tries to look at the global occurrence as opposed to just the local context, which is the difference in Bloom and the words is very good. There's also fast text. Fast text works in a different way, and it's so what FastText says is this, it doesn't care about FastText, you know. So the thing with research is that everybody tries to improve what they do. Right? So you would think that the hierarchy went from DBSM to BenQ, to Colossus, to Econos. Now, we'd expect that fast text would improve on this. Fast text said no. Instead of this, let's improve on this. Right? What fast text says is this. If you have a word today, I don't think that was going to be today's example. the observation of Nigeria happened a long time ago. Is it a long time ago?
It's a long time ago.
So what that sex is, right? Don't use the words as they are. Break them into some words. Right. So amalgamation, you can get what from this. Amalgamation. Imagination. I don't think so. cannot be just from here. I get he can get half. He can get. I think that's everything. Yeah, that's actually a very good term. So, Fasten says to break the world into subwords. So the subwords can be either engrams or homotherms. You can even use steps, depending on what you mean. Fasten was not by Facebook. Globe was not by Samsung. So when they did engrams, they used, when they did Fasten, they used a thin map of three. Right. So an engram is just break these words into three bits each. So instead of amalgam, it's just be AMM, MMD, ALG, ATI. So you are creating an entirely new vocabulary with the soft words. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. So that's basically what FastX is. Instead of using the words as you've seen there, just use, just break them into smaller words, and then use. So why? I think the question is why you break them into smaller words? Because the smaller bits can have a relationship with another word.
Okay.
Right. So instead of big words, sometimes you lose the meaning. You know, you might not find any relationship between a big word and another big word. But if you break it into smaller chunks, you can try to combine smaller chunks together better than you combine larger chunks of words. That's What was our
function? I have collaboration and ammunition.
Ammunition. Okay. What's the most important thing? So the trick is that you are looking for similarity. Right? So what you are looking for is if you have a so let's have this boss, right, of your vocabulary. We have to come up with a mission. You said combination. All that things will happen. And we have happened. The first step is you should turn into this. Like you have, if you use for example, an engram of three, meaning you're considering every three words. So you say AML, AML, you have MFA, we have LGA, and the rest of them. So what we are going to have at the end of the day is going to be a set, a unique set of all the engrams. So the confusion you are talking about them won't happen, right? Because AMM and AMM will be similar. And it's just pick one. You know, it's a unique set at the end of the day. You just want all the smaller chunks, not repeated smaller chunks. You need smaller chunks. Does that answer your question? Are you sure? Okay, yes, thank you.
But saying that the only option was that the unique set, you're not going to be there as they can be.
Yeah.
And then ammunition will have that for it, right?
Yeah, that's also another way of doing it. So, there's a big problem with FastX, right?
Oh, in, so
bad. That's one. Can someone pick up on the another problem with FastX?
Which of engram do you have?
Yeah, so that's one problem.
Very
So that's a lot. Like, people don't. The person is different. So one of the big problems we have is that in most cases it's very difficult to replicate outside English. Right. Take Europa. Okay, it goes back to what you said, that the smaller terms might not have been. But in most cases in English there's some chance, there's a high chance that you have to meet. But take Europa where it breaks into smaller terms. It's not that. So at the end of the day, you have a very large vocabulary of things you only be able to use. Let me give you a typical example. When you get home, right, download plastics. It's not very large, but it's big. I mean, there's a small subset that you know you can just play around.
How about it?
It's not very large.
So first sex, when they release first sex, they release a small version and a big version. I mean, they release versions for different languages. There's one for Yoruba. Yeah, they built it on Wikipedia and Yoruba. So there's no, it's horrible. That's the point I'm trying to make. Because one, if you build up your right hand very resource of your copies. One, it's not very much. Two, the bulk of the text you have there are not referenced. So meaning that
the whole world has a different
In the Wikipedia entry, right? You just have it stay as the same unit, so they can just have a retranslation of the wrong one. So why the resource Facebook is not very big. You can download.
It's not marked from Wikipedia, I have an issue. Is the issue that the fact that the text, the corpus of Wikipedia is not marked, like Baba is not marked this way, or they're not sure the words are not marked. Because I feel that the engrams can take note of the quotation and they make them like an extra alphabet.
Remember, I said the default engram is 2, 3. You're right, a tonal language. Yeah. Break this here. Don't even break it off. You have Baba, you have Baba. And then you try to check similarity, and then it doesn't pass by similar to Baba. You understand what I'm trying to say? I mean, if you remove the marks, obviously it's correct. But at the end of the day, if you put the marks there, then you have something. So, I was supposed to come here and talk about something different from this before. Right? I was supposed to talk about NLP from doing no resource like this. We should have dealt, given us enough time to actually go deep into this problem. Right? So, we just decided to come up here. So, hopefully, I'll get another chance to come back and talk about this in more context. Alright, because we love the problem we have here because it's not, we don't have a lot of preposition data for Yoruba and you love Nigerian languages. So, like I said, what you want to do is download the first steps. Right? Download the small version. It doesn't matter how long it takes. I just feel around. You get a view of this, you know, this is around, right? So the major improvement of fast text is that it supports a lot of out-of-vocabulary words. You know, since the words have been broken into smaller chunks, if you want to check any word that's not regular, there's a very good chance that you get it because the words have been broken down. So this is one of the major advantages of fast text. There's another version of fast text called probabilistic fast text, which actually improves our flow. Remember, it says fast text went to be good. So then they made an improvement that then went to improve flow instead of So whichever one it is you use, it's still the fast text context. So the normal fast text doesn't use probabilistic. It just uses a very short format. But this probabilistic fast text uses probabilistic, so I can check. This ones are not very popular, but I've come across them a few times, especially when you're working with conversational systems. So what these guys do is that they use crowds instead, right? So what Pancake and Bayes is trying to do is, instead of just trying to check the program's request, so they said probably it's here's a hyperbolic theory, right? And then you use, let's say, you have a circle here and you have a graph from the circle to various points. Now, the interesting thing about this is that this man is related to the woman. Right? And this woman can be related to something else here. Right? Let's say girl can be related to something completely different here. Boy. Right? So instead of having from one end to another and stop there, this guy just move. You have a central point. Right, and then you can move from wherever end is it comes to you. So that's basically what Pancake embedded strikes. You can see an illustration of this here. So you have the context right here. You know, so from here you can move from any points, move from here to here, which can move to another point. So I think those are all the different
Yes,
they do.
Very advanced sex.
I've looked at all these methods of representing ones. The last thing I want to cover is just applications of quantum mechanics. So before I move there, let's just take questions. But should I just finish everything and take questions? Yes.
Which one is your favorite?
Sorry?
Which one is your favorite?
Which one is my favorite?
No.
I don't like fast text. So, I don't like fast text preferably because it is taking a lot of things. Because you know the fast text process is you have your vocabulary piece. You first split your vocabulary into n-grams, right? This is one entire process on its own. After this, then go to this process of now comparing the similarity to the words. In most cases, you are not going to do this yourself. There are already pre-used embeddings that you can just download and use. But in some cases, you just want to, let me do this to myself. I don't like fast steps. What's the back is relatively old. You and it came out in 12-13, right? Below came out in 15. Fastest came out in 16. These guys, this 1, 2, 3, 4 are based on this. Right? This one, everybody uses that, even if you're not being NLP. So you still get that. You should write a loophole, no one really uses it anymore. Right? But there's still a loophole concept, but it definitely exists. Prepositional semantics, who has been doing that? Any market. I'm not aware of anyone that uses this. So I don't think that. I use I have something here that I call the bonus slide. I was hoping it's so my plan here was to highlight in quotes modern ways of embedding words, representing words. And then I was going to talk about skate parks. Okay, so everything we look at so far is the meaning of the given law, right? That's what we're interested in. So we're looking at basic box semantics. So there's another bit which is the composition of semantics, which is the rule of the combination of words. Instead of just looking at the words in the different way, you combine them and then you say, okay, what does the combination of this word mean? And that's, if you think about it, that's a bit better than looking at words in isolation. Right? So there's a very popular concept here. So the model is also that look at the sum of them. They embed the sum of the words in it, right? Just because they're matrix. So but there's another problem. My device though is almost the same as the black one. So in some context, you can say this guy and this guy are similar. This is in the big drum, I'm not going to read this. It's the same thing as if you check your words, you're also similar. Now, in what vague terms, you can't compare all of this or not this. You want to compare words, similarity between words. So the much more modern method tries to compare a combination of words. And the concept behind the law of them is that it's eight thoughts. Okay. I'm not going to talk about eight thoughts again. But if you're really interested in it, you can actually read up on the script. So the question script of answers is how can we model the structure with their meaning as opposed to just the individual words and its meaning? How many people here are taking part in actually being extreme? Extreme. Have you ever extreme? No way. If you're looking at actually being extreme, it's currently going on. It's a competition, like a global competition for students. No. So one of the questions that they love asking in extreme is taking distance. Not even extreme. How can I list code? You see a lot of questions around this. So, what edit distance basically says is you have how many steps do I have to move to go from this to this? You understand the question? How many steps have goods? Yeah, maybe. How many steps? You know, you're operating one, so you A is one, B is two, C is three, and all of that. So how many steps do I have to move to go from base to food. You know, so the first thing is, if you start with base, in common center, you will be already.
Four.
So, C, D, and E. So the first one is three steps, right? Four steps, right? You go on to the next one, right? And then you do the same thing. And we compare it for a large text of documents. You know that the words that have very small head distance are very similar. That's where this was the method for finding what similarity is. Let me explain it again. You have TAP, TAP. And you have CAF, CAP. How many steps do you want to move from CAF to CAF? You know that if the distance is very small compared to CAF and that word, it means that CAF and that word is closer. Sorry, CAF and CAF are closer compared to CAF and that word, meaning that those two are similar. So that was, it was an iterative curve. It's an iterative problem. There's also recursive solutions. You can use WordNet, other stemma, lemmatization using dictionaries. Right? So, this dictionary loop basically. This is one application, but the most popular application of WordNet. This is an example of the use of WordNet from the paper, from the lot of paper, I just took this. If you check, so the trend was to get 6 million words from news articles, and this was part of the results. Capital city, we were able to get Athens and Greece, Oslo and Norway. So, to a very good extent, what's the best works? Like, it works very well. The problem starts when we are trying to move what to get from English to non-English language. That's the one. Two, when there's not a lot of relationship between the words in your sentence or in your text, right? What to get works so well that it's able to get that B is similar to B, right? Ideally, we assume that first text would get this.
Yeah.
But what's the very cost of getting this, which is interesting. Because I'm not assuming what's the very cost of getting this. But what this means is that there's an entry in the sentence that has big and bigger. Right? Well, in first text, even if big is not here, to still be able to get that big and bigger and related to each other. You notice that Nicolas Sarkozy and France, the former president of France, actually got that this was related. Copa and Cibio, right? Zinc, lead, and gold, uranium. So, as long as there's some form of context relationship between the words in your text, what's the effect going to get? So these are just examples. Another application of what's connected is machine translation. Classic methods, rule the statistical machine translation and morphological transformation. Part of speech tagging. Relation extraction, sentiment analysis. So, this is all the right use of what's connected. Because quite a lot of what a lot of people want to do sentiment analysis, they look at it as a classification problem. You have text with classes and you want to predict if it's positive, negative, or neutral. But you can also use the concept of what to text to actually solve the problem. And that is another thing. What you need to do is use the cosine distance to compare your own same text to your own review. So you know that. So let's say you have this in a text, And you want to try and do something like a sentimental analysis on this. You give the model here, you give your wants to the model, right? And let's say you use the context of soup. To consider the soup that you want. So the next time you come and you want to try and predict quality is what, it knows that these guys are similar already. Because you consider happy as part of this. Right? So in this case, if you represent this happy as positive instead, right? You know that whatever is going to come, there's a kind of probability of having positive here that actually has a negative. I don't know if you get what I'm saying. Should I explain that again? Okay. What sentiment analysis does, you have something like this. While it is happy, or yes, while it is positive, right? So while it is happy, you know that this is positive. Okay. So what you want to do is, you can use a friend of you put all these working classes, and again, you try to predict that it's positive or negative. So here's how you can also do it with what's the best for things. Have this steps, quality is happy, right? It knows that happy comes, if you consider a context of A equals 2, happy comes, happy is very close to value. So it means that if you want to actually predict that, okay, what is likely to come after this idea, you know that there's a high percentage that's going to be positive because of happy already represents. So you can do this for a larger set so that you don't need logistics to bring down or here and then bring down or something like for reference to solution, clustering, and semantic analysis of your field. So these are all the things you can use what's the time of course. I think that's effective. The final thing I should mention is that there is now a law of improvements to what's the text, so that you have paragraphs to beg, talk to beg, sentence to beg, image to beg, image to beg, bytes to beg, base to beg. In the final law, right? There's a particular. I'm not sure if it's against the reference. This particular thing, this number, like, I believe, says you would love the fact about possible that you use to give. So you can just check out any of these things if you want to go on about what representation or any other thing. So I think that's everything I want to cover here today. So any other pending questions? That's the only way to know what's going on. That's the fastest way to know what's going on. It's like, you know, the social media perceptions. they like to put in on their work. Right? So when somebody does something and it works, phones of other people want to prove it. So I think the trick for me as well is what is the latest perception? What is the latest trend? Right. So answer your question. I don't know if there's any such a site. I don't know if I do know this. Is looking for some ways to learn in NLP? Or is that what you're
doing? No, to get research papers improved and
to get research papers. Then I guess it's to get research
papers. No, I mean I have to do something that is
Everything for you, right?
Please stop that.
Exactly.
There's a popular, so you can check out papers with you can check out
I'm going to go to the next one.